early to the afternoon, so good morning to you all. Before I would start to present on the pediatric evaluations, I would like to thank Dr. Rekha Ramachandran for giving me an opportunity to be with you all. As told, I need to speak for 20 minutes on pediatric evaluations. This information goes to the parents and the people that are working in this field. So I thought I'll just briefly discuss about what are the key points where each one of us should know about their child, you know, how they are over a period of, you know, couple of months and years as they grow. So my headings will be mainly focused on a few key points on cardiac diseases, the growth, the hearing assessment, the ophthalmic disorders, the thyroid function assessment, the celiac disease, hematology, dental care, adrenal instability, behavior and psychological problems, sleep apnea, fertility and depression, Alzheimer's disease, what is the current research and future treatment options available, alternative treatments, society guidelines, and information for parents. So we know that growth is very important for these babies, for all of us. So we don't want to get, you know, kind of stunted in our growth or being obese. The most important thing is to monitor the growth disturbance. And some of these growth disturbances can be related to the thyroid function as well as a medical condition called as celiac disease. So if your child is not doing well in terms of growth, you need to evaluate these two things which are very important. Not only this, if you feel that the child is growing well, you don't need to feel very happy about it because they can lead to obesity. So you need to monitor the weight gain. Now there are various growth charts which are available, you know, on different parts of our world. There is American, there is European, there is UK. So we have our own standard growth charts, and this growth chart has to be with the parents and the institutions where the growth has to be plotted against the X and Y axis. What all we measure? We measure the height, weight, and head circumference. So at this talk, we need to also measure, you know, can calculate the body mass index. The overall goal of this monitoring is to prevent obesity. Now, babies do grow at different pace, and when you think that these babies are kind of on the higher side, we need to get them physically more so that the training happens, not only in terms of burning of their calories, probably also to help them to develop their milestones. Now what we are seeing is some of these babies, as they grow, they are deficient in calcium and vitamin D, and especially during the early adolescent and, you know, late adulthood, they should have adequate bone mineralization. So we need to think whether we should do the vitamin D, calcium and phosphorus levels and supplement with this, you know, essential minerals. Now when the baby is born, it is very important to evaluate the child for cardiac illness. So most of these babies, if they have any congenital heart disease that needs to be addressed, the outcome of most of the Down's babies related to cardiac disease is directly related, because we know that if a child has a major congenital heart disease, they will have a very rough course to start with, and probably we need to do a lot of things in order to get them to the mainstream. So an important cardiac evaluation has to be done soon after birth. And as the child grows, a lot of us think that, okay, the heart is normal, we don't need to further evaluate these babies. No, we are wrong at that. We need to have an annual or every 2 years evaluation of the cardiac function in these babies. Mainly because if their lungs are not good, that will put a stress on the right side of the heart, and that can lead to a problem later on in their life. So in order to prevent the right heart failure, we need to evaluate them. Some of these children, as they grow, the valves in their heart, which is, you know, able to prevent the blood flow, is kind of leaking. So we call it as mitral valve prolapse or aortic valve regurgitation. So we need to evaluate for that. So that is most important, you know, in terms of cardiac regulation as they grow. Now hearing is also an important assessment which has to be done soon after birth. So we have a website that's called OAE, and also there is a sophisticated, highly sensitive test called VELA. So it is a brainstem auditory response. Now, if the baby is not able to hear, we need to kind of get this baby's assessed quite regularly, and also get the otolaryngologist, the ENT specialist basically, and the speech therapist involved very early in their life. Now, a lot of these babies can have otitis media, that is secretions in the middle ear, which can cause conductive deafness. So when you look at these children with Down's babies, they don't have sensory neural deafness, but it's mainly a conductive deafness. So if you can address this conductive deafness, probably when the hearing impulse goes to their brain, they probably start having the speech, you know, therapy faster and learn vocabulary faster. Now, regarding the eye examination, yes, of course, soon after the birth, the baby has to be looked for the eye examination. What are the common things which we come across in children with Down's babies are basically the refractive errors, the nystagmus, which is the rolling of the eyeballs, and they can have premature cataracts. So we need to assess this important thing so that they don't have any visual disturbance and they can have fine eye and hand coordination, because the fine motor depends on eye and fine motor coordination, the hand movements. So if their vision is not good, they will struggle in terms of doing fine movements. Now when you look at this population, 50% of them can have refractive errors. So that's quite a significant number. So we need to assess that. And there are different guidelines in different countries when to assess annually, 6 monthly. So we have our own guidelines, which Dr. Rekha has in her website, which is nicely kind of projected. And parents should go through these guidelines and see what all has to be done at different stages. Now, as the child grows later on, they can also have lens opacities, and the cornea, which is in the center, the black part of our eye, can kind of bulge around. That is called as keratoconus. So that has to be evaluated. Now, coming to the thyroid function. So thyroid is such an important hormone. So we kind of talk sometimes with our colleagues, if that person is not very active, is not doing certain things, we just usually call them is a hypothyroid. But basically it means that when you have less thyroid hormone, you are too lazy. Your brain connections are not happening well. You are putting on weight. So all this, the heart rate comes down, you feel cold. These are some of the clinical signs and symptoms which we need to understand and try to find out whether we can intervene these babies by a simple blood test called TSH and T4. By doing this test, if the child has hypothyroidism, so you can start with a simple medicine called thyroxine, and that has to be continued and evaluated. And most of this metabolic endocrine thing is dealt with our endocrine specialist. So probably these children require a constant evaluation from them. Now when you see any child putting on weight, we probably have to assess for hypothyroidism. Or if your child is not putting on weight, if there is deceleration of growth, then again you need to think about what is going through your child and do for this. Now celiac disease in India we don't commonly see, but there is an association with Down syndrome. So basically what it means for the people who don't know is they are sensitive to some gluten protein, and this protein is present in most of the cereals what we eat, that is wheat, rye, barley and wool. So if your child has loose stools, not putting on weight, repeated infections, diarrhea, 10% of them can have constipation, and they are stunned during first year, second year of life, you need to evaluate these babies if there are any signs and symptoms. And the diagnostic test, there are some factors. The gold standard is doing a small bowel biopsy. So then the gastroenterologist probably will be involved to do the biopsies, and we need to eliminate the gluten-free diet. So those babies, once they put on gluten-free diet, they do very well.